Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is Hani Ismail from Planning Engineer website. In this special lesson, I would like to discuss with you the planning best practices. We studied in the course so far the planning package and how it is being done. But now I would like to give you some tips and tricks regarding planning best practices. Whether you are a project manager, construction manager, or site engineer, you need to have some information which is really will be beneficial for your project. So from our many projects we have created, we have something we can advise you, and we'll discuss some tips and tricks. We'll share with you the best practices in the most of the planning tasks. Let's start with the activity ID. As you know, the activity ID is a numbering, and every activity should have this activity ID. But there is a best practice of having the activity ID. You can have it as a random number, which is something not good, but you can have it organized. How you can organize your activity ID? This is my recommended way of doing activity ID. You have one section for project code, then is dash, then another section for activity type, then dash, then building code, then floor code, then division code, then the master activity ID. I'm going to explain my point of view for each section we discussed here to give you the overall idea. So the project code, you can assign 3 digits for all your projects. So once you read any schedule, you can easily recognize which project we are talking about. The number of the project in your company, initial project name, whatever characters you are going to use, you can fix them up to 3 digits here and use them efficiently. The second portion is the activity type. The activity type, it will tell you whether this activity is a milestone, and it can be shop drawing, procurement, construction, testing and commissioning, and this is the abbreviations I'm using for each one of them. Also, the building code is very important because I would like to know which building I'm looking at. So you can say this is building 1, building 2, building 3, or if it is a road, road 1, 2, 3, or if it is an area, or zone, or X, or whatever, according to your project situation. So it is very beneficial to have building or area code. Floor code also is very useful because when you are looking at any activity, you will recognize which floor we are talking about. We are here, for example, underground, we can use it UG. Basement BS, ground floor GF, first floor 1F, and so on. Actually, from my clients, I'm doing services for them, planning and project management services. This one of the comments we receive usually that this is very nice numbering system. They like it, so I also prefer to give it to you how I'm doing it. The division code also will give you a very good understanding of the activity, whether it is earthwork, substructure, superstructure, finishing, mechanical, electrical, and so on. Also, later on, you can filter any activity by using any of these digits. Finally, the master activity ID. What I'm doing in my projects, let's say the excavation activity will always be C001. But you can say now, Yahani, it will be repeated. No, because it might be in different building or floor or division. So this, whenever I see C001, it means I'm talking about excavation works. This is what I called master activity ID. So it is very beneficial to have this master activity ID. So if you would like to make a filter for a certain activity, it will be very easy. Let's guess the activity details. From this look, I can say some information. What is the project code? Definitely M60. What is the activity type? Is it construction, procurement, or shop drawings? From this code, I can say easily it is a shop drawing. What about the floor? Can you tell the floor? Yes, because 7F here will tell me this is the 7th floor. And this is building 6, by the way, also. What's the division of work? Is it civil, architectural, mechanical, or electrical? Because I have this code here, it is very obvious it is architectural. So this is what I'm talking about. You can easily find the information from just looking to your activity ID. Let's have another example. Can you guess now? The project code is MJT, activity type, it is testing and commissioning. The area is zone 2 because it's ZD2. Floor is second underground floor. Division of work is electrical because we have here EL. So I hope you got the overall idea. The idea here is to have your activity ID, which will give you an overall understanding of the activity even before reading the activity name. Then we'll come to the activity name. What the tips and the tricks we recommend for the activity name? It is important to have the activity name very clear. So you cannot call an activity ceramic. It is not sufficient. No level of details were provided. Instead, we can call it installation of ceramic floor tiles, first floor, for example. This is more specific and it gives the reader the required information to understand what you are talking about. Installation of ceramic floor tiles, first floor, let's know this is a construction activity. So when you say installation, the term is being also specified as construction, not shop drawing, not procurement. Also, we can add the name or the code of the beginning, like B49. So now we're talking about the specific building, if we have too many buildings in our schedule. So to make it summarize, the bad activity name will have a very generic word without sufficient information. In order to make it a good activity name, we can change the ceramic activity to an installation of ceramic tiles first floor. Same as the painting, you have to say which coat. For example, we have painting first coat and then you mention the floor. Footing shop drawings is not good because you should specify the building and whether it is RC or BC footing, and you mention also whether it is shop drawing, submetal or approval. Concrete, also this is not good activity name. You can say this is reinforced concrete for columns second floor. This is how you can make the activity names looks better. One more thing, that you cannot combine too many activities in one. Like concrete of building B1, it is better to have an activity for each structural element. Delays could be due to any part of the structure system, and if you not have a sufficient level of details, then you cannot find where are the problems. Also, formwork for columns, steel reinforcement for columns, concrete pouring for columns. Over detailing the activity also is not useful unless you have a very good reason to have very detailed structure of your activities. It will cost you time and money in order to calculate the progress, the hours, the cost for each activity. So always keep it in the middle. No too many details and not a very summarized activity ID. Now let's talk about the WBS or work breakdown structure. Creating the WBS is one of the most important steps in any project because this is how you will organize your activities, cost, progress and everything. Because all of these will be summarized to the WBS level. It is also important to agree with your stakeholders about the WBS you are going to use in your project. There might be some recommendation to segregate your project per building or per zone or per area. So it is good to know this information at the beginning. What's make a WBS is good? It will capture all the project work. If you miss something or important task, it won't be very good. And also tasks should be broken down into manageable level. So you cannot put the whole concrete in one WBS or one activity. You cannot manage it. Also, making too much details will not be a good practice. Using a clear language will make your WBS looks professional. If you have confusing terms leading to misunderstanding, this is not a good practice. Also, it is important to make your tasks directly support the project goals and deliverables. If you put irrelevant tasks into the WBS, this is also not a good practice. So WBS should be descriptive, cover all the scope, detail, consider engineering, procurement, testing and commissioning, definitely in addition to the construction. Distribute the activity by discipline. This is a sample of a good WBS. Bad WBS code has some spelling mistakes, too much abbreviations, wrong sequence. You might have the first floor before the ground floor. Doesn't cover all the activity. No detailed construction disciplines. No place for milestones. no place for engineering or procurement, no place for testing and commissioning. Cost loading. We cost loading our schedule in order to have a very detailed progress reporting. If we finish activity with a cost of 50% of the project total budget, we can say that we have finished 50% of the project. What if we have decided not to cost loading our schedule? In that case, how you are going to measure the progress? One of the benefits of having cost loading is to measure the planned percentage and the actual percentage in a proper way. So if you decide not to cost load your schedule, you can still monitor the progress, but you will need to rely on other key performance indicators or KPIs like physical progress. Instead of using cost, you can track the progress based on the percentage of physical completion of activity. You can assign weightage to each activity based on efforts, duration, or importance. This is not the most accurate way of measuring progress. We usually use it as a secondary KPI or key performance indicator. Earned value management, EVM, using units. If your project tracks work based on units like cubic meter, concrete poured, kilometers of roads, etc., you can still measure the progress using the units. However, it is very rare to have a project with only one unit because you cannot combine, let's say, cubic meters along with kilometers of roads. You need to compare apple to apple. So the conversion happens when you cost load your schedule. However, if you have one activity with one unit, it's okay to measure by units. Resource usage. If you track resources, labor, equipment, materials, monitoring the usage of the resources can give an idea of project progress related to the plan. Also, this is another way if you don't want to cost load your project. Milestone tracking. You can define key milestones across the project. Once one stage is completed, you can assign some weight to it. And this is another way of monitoring your project. However, all these methods are a second way of monitoring the project. The basic way, or the primary way, is to have cost and using the earned value management. Let's have a comparison from actual P6 schedule to understand actual percentage based on cost and the actual percentage based on duration. Actual percentage based on duration, this is in case we don't have cost loading. So as you can see here, performance percentage completed, which is this one, different than duration percentage completed, which is this one. Performance percentage completed is calculated based on cost, while duration percentage completed is based on duration. So if you monitor this project and you decide not to cost load the project, the actual will be 62.08%. In the other hand, if you cost loaded the project in a proper way, you will find that the actual only 54.22. The differences is coming from the cost loading calculations and the duration calculations. Let me tell you the differences. Performance percentage complete equal to earned cost divided by total cost. In the other hand, duration percentage complete equal to elapsed duration divided by original duration. By logic, elapsed duration will equal to original duration minus remaining duration. So this is not the best way to monitor your project. One last thing I would like to talk about is resource loading. After finalizing resource calculation, the output of this phase is how many hours will be spent from different professions to execute this amount of work. Some planner, when they build their time schedule, calculate the total hours need and load it in Primavera as one resource, which is called labor resource. This is not a common practice or a proper way of loading resources. You can have all your resources as one resource, or you can have them in professions. So you know how many technicians, how many painters, how many helpers. So if you have one resource only, so you'll have one resource curve only. But if you have a resource for each profession, you will have resource curve for each profession. When you have one labor resource, you will have only overall average daily manpower. But if you have a detailed resource for each profession, you will have the average daily manpower for each profession. In that case, when you have a peak or drop, you cannot know its reason. But if you have a details, you can specify which profession is leading to peaks or drops in the curve. If you have one labor resource, you cannot control and monitor each profession. On the other hand, if you have a different resource for professions, you can easily control and monitor each profession. Finally, the duration estimation. When it comes to the duration estimation, you need to take care about some conditions while estimating the duration, like the weather conditions, resource availability, permitting and regulations and approvals, productivity variation over time. So this is very important while you are doing duration estimation. You have weather conditions and resources availability. In the resources availability, if one labor rate is 100 meter per day and the quantity is 1000 meter and you are limited to 5 labor per day, then you are limited to the rate of 500 meter per day, which means you need 2 days minimum. But will increase the resources always increase the productivity? Definitely not, because we have some limitation. Like Warren Buffett say, you cannot produce a baby in 1 month by getting 9 women pregnant. Sometimes people get crazy about productivity. They say, okay, we'll crash a project, we'll put more resources, we'll finish it in 2 months instead of 1 year. You have some limitations, because as more resources are added, the productivity increase will initially raise but then eventually fall. Beyond a certain point, adding more worker or equipment may not result in the relevant increase of the productivity. Also, you need to check the resource availability. If a small team is laying concrete, adding few more workers might speed up the process. But if too many workers are added, they may start getting in each other's way, leading to inefficiencies. So there are too many things to be discussed in the planning, but we choose these topics in order to give you the best practices. However, if you are interested more in the planning, we provide planning courses starting from basic course, then intermediate course, then professional course. If you would like to dive in and get more and more information about the planning field, you are welcome to study our courses. Thank you very much for watching this lesson. Hope it was useful to you. See you in the next one.